you want to go see a play, and I'm not talking about a small community play, and we have some very, very talented people in our local theaters, but if you want to go see an arts club production that's touring, you have to go to Surrey, you have to go to Abbotsford, you have to go to Maple Ridge, where they do have facilities for this. Now, as the we have the bridge, thank you for the bridge, by the way. Let's acknowledge it. But because of, for example, the tolls, there are some people that made the decision not to go into Vancouver or to Burnaby or New West to see plays. So the arts community in Vancouver are sending more and more actors and productions out to the valley. So the other day, there would be a production in Surrey for 39 Steps. That's an arts club production. That was put on in Surrey. A couple of years ago, that might not have happened. Had we had a facility years ago in a thriving arts community, that production would have been shown in Langley. So we need to have some type of arts center, not just for the painters that we have. I say I'm not painters because I'm just surrounded by this beautiful art. But we also have poets and musicians that need a place. We have graphic artists that need a place. There's a whole scale of people that are involved in the arts. And I just want to mention about the economic spin on it. So for every dollar that's invested by the province in arts, there's at least a dollar and a half generated from that. And we should be encouraging that. The provincial government does give money to the arts, via the arts councils throughout the province. It's not a huge amount compared to the rest of the budget, but it is very important because of that spin-off.
Right. In terms of the benefit to a community when you have an arts facility located, where my mind went to was the kind of changes we've seen, especially in a community like Langley, when you have the entry of more big box type retail outlets. If you look around Langley, one of the biggest challenges that we faced in the last, I'm going to say 10 or 15 years, maybe a little longer, but I think that's where it's really been highlighted. You have a challenge drawing people into the parts of town that have the small stores. Langley's blessed with a whole lot of small retail outlets, small tiny shops that specialize, and one of the biggest challenges they have is just drawing traffic there. People will come if they have a specialized interest, but for a shop to survive, they need more than that. They need pass-through traffic as well. And one of the great benefits of being able to have locations where you have art going on, where you draw people in for another experience. Shane talked about the kind of things that artists purchase, but there's also the spin-off of people who come because they're drawn to something like this. They come and take a look at the gallery and the different artwork, but other facilities and communities, look at Fort Langley, for example, what they've been able to do with a multitude of galleries. Draws people in for a different reason, but it can have a huge benefit if you can locate those in areas where currently you really don't have as much of a draw. And I think it's one of the advantages we have in Langley, if we can begin to try and harness that throughout our community. It can be one of the ways we help to bring business back to some of the smaller areas of town. So truly, there's a tremendous benefit when you have arts facilities, and you do have to expand your thinking about arts. That's one of the things you see here. We're surrounded by the paintings, but there's all sorts of different types of art that draw people in, whether it's jewelry or even looking at some of the more unique pieces around here. People want to see that, and we can find ways to support that better in the community, that's going to certainly have a tremendous spin-off for our local businesses. In terms of the arts, culture, and heritage, and the interconnection of health and wellness, so we'll probably all find out we have musical or artistic connections. Mine was piano. On my dad's side, all my cousins are off successfully playing in symphonies and orchestras. I have a cousin who plays cello for the VSO. I didn't manage to do that because at some point, much to my mother's disappointment, I decided I had a boyfriend that was more important than piano and went off a different direction. But I had some time where, just due to circumstances, We had to put the piano into hock, and life goes on, but I spent about 5 years without having a piano in my house. And you know, I didn't really realize the impact of that until I managed to get another piano and bring it into the house. And I realized how much of an emotional outlet that had been for me. I mean, you kind of know that theoretically, but really hadn't put it all together until the piano came back into my life. And I know from my mother, she died of colon cancer a number of years ago. And when she was in the palliative care ward, music therapy in the hospital was absolutely enormous. We know too from the research in education that when you have children with severe cognitive disabilities, autism for example is one, but there are a number of others, where music can be an absolute clear entry point into other forms of thinking and into communication. So there's something about the rhythm of life and the rhythm of our thinking that connects to our health, and the research is pretty clear on that. So to the extent that we can include that not only in people's daily lives as some form of habit, some form of outlet, whether it's writing or painting or music, it not only contributes to our mental health and well-being, our emotional health and well-being, but the evidence is pretty clear that for those who are suffering some kind of medical condition, it can be clearly demonstrated that it assists them in their healing, or if they're on a journey toward the end of life, it can certainly assist them in the management of pain and help them to have an easier passage.
The relation between arts and economics is undeniable. And it's also because art is a product. It is produced, it is consumed, and as Shane mentioned earlier, the BC government's own reports have the return on investment in art being $1.38 for every dollar that's invested. And so I think that's something there, but you can also look at areas of extreme urban decay. Look at Brooklyn or look at parts of Harlem, for example, and look at the things they're doing there now. They've managed to turn Brooklyn into an artistic hub where they're valued for that and they're known for that. And what they get out of that is they have an entire class of people moving there to participate within that, but also taking day trips there. And those are the people that spend locally at small businesses, right? They go out to the local vineyards here, they come to a restaurant, they go to the local coffee shop. So I think there's also that effect as well. But between, speaking of the interconnection of health and wellness, I think that's undeniable here for anybody that's ever been broken up with, anybody that's ever been depressed, anybody that's ever, you know, gone through a stage in their life where they just really need to shut the door and listen to music, or look at a painting, or read a poem. I think if you want to look at a more visceral example of malaise in society and the effect art can have, look at refugees coming to Canada. You're talking about people that have been violently torn from their place of origin and who are having trouble connecting to the host culture. I've had my own experiences, which have been much more moderate. I lived in Italy for a year, and moving there speaking no Italian was very alienating, and it's tough. Italians aren't really known for their linguistic ability with English, but they're very expressive, and sometimes that helps too. But when you're in a position like that, it's natural to turn to the arts to help you, because the arts are universal, but also to help you heal the profound psychic malaise you feel at being a fish out of water and dealing with that kind of alienation. So I think that there's a role there. In terms of funding, I think that's a discussion that needs to happen after we see the state of the books and the province's finances, before we make specific commitments like that. But an art facility would contribute to society and the community here, absolutely. And there's a great role that it can play in terms of youth engagement, and I think that it has to, if it's going to be valuable. I mean, you do have the example of colonization and the effect that that's had on Aboriginal peoples, and the role that art has played in reclaiming their sense of identity. But there's also a question of just youth engagement as a whole. Look at voting. Young people, I'm 27 years old, people that are under 30 vote at a rate of less than 30%. And with that decline in engagement, there's also a decline in societal and communal engagement that are going hand in hand with that. So getting them interested, getting them involved, of course that's important. And there's different ways that could look. I think Shane spoke about encouraging young people to play guitar and be musical. Or you could have classes on art history for people that are interested. We have a very strong tradition of local art here. But what you tend to learn about is the Ontarian tradition of the Group of Seven and Tom Thompson, and that's very interesting. It gives us a short shrift here. So I think that there's a lot of room for that as well.